remember? Did you forget, or did you remember?
No, I knew. I have been non-stop today. I'm literally just going from one thing to the next to the next, and I was like,
"Oh, bless you." Well, I saw it said Natasha's going live, and this was like earlier on, and my stomach dropped. I was like, "That's not with me." No. And then obviously you've done your mindful chat and everything else, and God, you're like the social media queen.
It's been a busy day, and I was waiting for you to go live, and then I thought, well, maybe I should just text you to let you know I'm actually here waiting.
Oh, no, that's absolutely fine. Thank you so much for doing this. I really appreciate it. I've been...
And apologies that my face is so close to the phone, but my phone won't charge properly at the moment, and it's really...
Oh, no. Well, when I first did these, I tried to make it all like a bit more... My seat set up like outside, and it was really nice. And I thought, I just prefer just chatting. So I was like, I'm going to have my pillows. I'm going to relax. But it's probably too early probably to have a drink.
Where are you based?
Well, this is the thing. I'm in Ipswich.
Oh.
Which you've been to for Canto. And
yeah.
I'm sure it is on Wikipedia, so for God, it's probably...
Oh, one. God, don't talk to me about Wikipedia.
It said you moved to Ipswich in, like... I'm sure it said, like, 2005 you moved to Ipswich or something. I was like, did you?
No. I mean, as lovely as Ipswich is.
I reckon someone just keeps adding things to Wikipedia, like...
So it's weird. I've seen things on Wikipedia and I'm like... Oh, that's interesting. No one told me that.
Well, I'm interviewing someone next week. I haven't announced it yet. And it said that they were nominated for a Brit Award and a Mobile Award. I spoke to the person earlier and she was like, I wish we were. She was like, we weren't. I was like, I'll take... So I've had to redo their video kind of thing. But I was like, are you sure? You know, but...
Yeah. I tried to actually update my own Wikipedia and it wouldn't allow me to. It was like, yeah, this update's been denied. I was like, but it's me. This isn't true.
I know this shit I've done.
It's actually me. And they were like, yeah, no, we're not going to accept that.
Oh, bless you. Well, look, thank you so much for this. Now, I know I've spoken to different people. You've done so many interviews with so many different people, not just when you're an Atomic Kitten, but like afterwards. Lockdown. So, I don't want to spend like ages talking about Atomic Kitten because no doubt you're bored to death talking about it as well. But you can't deny,
yeah,
the stuff you guys did. I almost think it's... I'm finding this a lot with a lot of 90s and early noughties pop bands, is how different it would have been. I mean, you're huge anyway, but I think if that had been now, with the amount of records you sold, you would quadruple people that are getting number ones now through just streaming. Like, it's mad. It's like, and again, it will change again in another 10 years. Well, it's 20 years, isn't it, since Hole Again?
20, yeah.
That's mad.
Maybe so.
You know, did you want to be a pop star? Or did you want to do more musical theatre?
I wasn't a big fan of musical theatre only because I've always had a really husky voice. Yeah. And I've always struggled singing like musical theatre songs. Like, I sound like a strangled cat.
Yeah.
So for me, I was like, musical theatre is not going to be my thing. It's just not going to suit my voice vocally. But for me, I wanted to travel.
Yeah.
So I was looking at cruise ships. So yeah. I basically, from the age of 12...
Did you ever do a cruise ship?
I auditioned for one cruise ship and I got the job. And then when they found out I was only 16, they were like, oh, you're not allowed on a cruise ship until you're 18.
Yeah.
To be honest, a lot of the girls in my college were really pissed off as well because they were like older and they were like trying to get the job and I got offered it. So I was like, sorry about that.
But yeah, so you did, you weren't really into musical theatre, but you did, I know you've spoken about before in other interviews and things like that, but you did suffer with some bullying, like...
Oh, So for me, performing was escapism because when I was at school, I was really badly bullied.
Yeah.
So I was bullied for being the kid with the brace. I mean, I had my first brace when I was 7, which was like, that was just odd back then. I was the ginger kid. I was the kid with the mixed race dad.
Yeah.
You know, I used to get told that my dad wasn't my real dad all the time. Just loads of different things. I had a bit, you know, there was something about me. I wasn't sat in the background. I was always like, hey, like I always had personality. I had confidence. And yeah, I was bullied quite badly. And I don't know whether it's a young kid thing or a scouse thing, but it wasn't like you just didn't tell. So I kind of suffered for a couple of years, like, you know, being punched and hit and tripped and tricked. So for me, singing was...
You're like escapism.
Yeah. So for me, I just threw myself into it. Plus, when I sang, people were saying nice things to me. I wasn't getting bullied. So people were like, that was really good. I was getting praise. So for me, I was like, oh, well, I'm going to do more of that. Because when I do that, people like me.
Yeah.
So there's no surprise that I ended up being a really good singer when I was younger, because that's just where I was like, that's where I need to be. That was my safe zone.
Yeah. I say that to a lot of kids now. It's a really weird thing that when you're learning the skill and wanting to be a singer or dancer or anything in the performing arts, so you do get ripped for it. I remember I did. And it's funny that coming out the other side of it, when you are doing like the really good gigs and you're going like abroad or you're working with like really, not just celebrities, but really inspirational, big people that make a change. And suddenly those bullies, I'm always thankful to some of them for I don't know if you're the same, like giving you that
check. Fire.
Yeah. And the drive and the, like I said, the fire to succeed and be like, who's just had a number one? Do you know what I mean? Like,
oh, listen, I couldn't wait to get out of Liverpool, really, because it was tough. It was a tough place to grow up. I had, you know, a tough environment growing up. And all I wanted to do was perform. And I knew that in order to do that, it would be moving out of Liverpool.
Yeah.
So it was just, I just wasn't fazed. Like, by the time Atomic Kitten come around, I'd been to that many auditions, you know, some I'd won, some I'd failed miserably at. Yeah. I was used to rejection. I didn't take rejection well at all. If I didn't win a competition, I was like depressed and, you know, dramatic and all this like carry on.
Yeah.
But it just made me want it even more. And plus, to be honest, my dad was like quite ruthless. Like from a very young age, he said to me, girl, you've got a good voice, but there's going to be a load more people with better voices than you have there. Yeah, that's what he said. He went, so don't get too big for your boots.
Yeah.
But you know what that taught me? That taught me not to be jealous and to actually, instead of envy, see, like, aspire to be like the good singers. So when someone started singing, I'd go, wow.
Yeah.
Like, I just had this aspiration to get better.
Yes,
instead
definitely.
Of having this insecurity of, oh, they're better than me. Yeah. And to be honest, a lot of people in the entertainment industry were insecure people, were seeking, you know, acceptance. Yeah. So even though it was a bit tough, like it was like tough love, it actually really helped.
Yeah. And that's really good as well. And it's important. One thing I find really refreshing with you a lot is you're so... probably like myself, it gets you in trouble sometimes, but you are so honest. You're just, you've said, like, what I love, I hate it when pop stars or celebrities or influencers, oh, why did you do it? Oh, it's for the experience. And you're like, the money. So you're like, I needed the money. I'm not going to lie. I saw a thing you did and I was to myself. You said, I remember, it was at the Nicorette patches. And you were like, I was lying there covered in these Nicorette things. And I thought to myself, what the hell am I doing? But that's so refreshing. And I think that's why a lot of people love you and they like you, because you would just go, I did Big Brother. I needed the money. I did. You've said it on here. You're like, I have bills to pay. I've got stuff to sort out. And I will say to people, when I first messaged you, I took away what you actually said to me. You said, I just need to kind of make sure I'm doing enough my personal life and then enough social media and business. You know, I'm just getting a you know, balance, and I'll let you know. And I thought, do you know what? Like, nail on the head.
Yeah. I think it's really important to look after, like, just like your time, your space, your energy. Yeah. And I'm a giver. I give a lot. I love just help. If someone says, can you come and do this? If it helps them, if my story, you know, reaches another ear and it helps them, I'm like, yeah, like, I'm all for that. But I got to a point in lockdown and I was just going to bed exhausted. And I was thinking, what have I actually done for myself today?
Yeah. Exactly.
And so I had to just reassess the balance. But
yeah.
I'm at an age now. I'm just at a point in my life where, like, I'm far from perfect, but if I start veering off the path, I'll go, oh, hang on a minute, something's not quite right, and I'll get back on it.
Yeah.
Whereas definitely. When I was younger, I off the path was my favourite place. Now I'm quite, like, boring. I'm like, no, I'll stick on the path, please.
No, I know this route quite well. I ain't going over there. Yeah. I think it's, you've always been, like, honestly, and I do think karma, like the fate of the way things come. I absolutely fangirled one of my favorite bands of all time. It was The Life I Wish I Had, and I said it to them when I got to meet them. It was the Backstreet Boys.
Yeah. And
they came randomly to Ipswich, and you were there. You were backstage.
Oh. Oh, was this a 5 gig?
Yes, 5 Backstreet Boys.
Yes.
What was with McBusted? If anyone's watched, McBusted were headlining, and I was like,
"Was it a daytime thing?"
Yes. Yeah.
I remember. I was very heavily pregnant.
Yes, and I remember you were. It was really hot. Backstreet Boys also. I mean, Backstreet Boys were just like my world when I was growing up because I loved the dance and the singing, and like I say, it was the career I wanted. But McBusted were like the headline, but I was like, "Nah, Backstreet Boys." But you were doing Panto in Ipswich as well. You did Snow White or Cinderella, was it?
Snow White. I was the Wicked Queen. I loved it. Oh, that's probably the best role I've ever played. The baddie is the
playing
best.
The villain.
Yeah, I made a few kids cry. I was like, yes.
Yeah. Well, what that was going to say, like, things that hopefully you've not been asked for. One thing I loved with you guys in Atomic Kitten was, and I swear you were one of the first people to do, I don't know, maybe you weren't. In the video, I Want Your Love, I remember it coming out and there was the dance break. The
Michael Jackson vibes.
But it was like the music stopped. And like Pussycat Dolls have done it and every other band does it now. And I remember looking everywhere for it. And obviously, back in the day, you couldn't just YouTube because there wasn't any. Oh, that's what's going on. You know the symbol? Was that a symbol you girls have put together? It was like the cat with the dynamite coming out of it.
I mean, I can't take credit for that. To be fair, that's probably the best I could ever draw. I'm not a drawer. I don't know. Do you have, like, teams? Don't be that. When we first launched, it was Atomic Kitten. It just said Atomic Kitten.
Yes.
And had the kitten face with the, like, the kind of dynamite thing
bomb,
coming off. And it was just that. They didn't actually put a picture of us. It didn't say girl band. So it was just a little bit like, what is Atomic Kitten? It didn't say it was a song. It was just like Atomic Kitten and a date.
Yeah.
So it was actually really cool because we used to be chatting like,
that's us!
That's us! You know, really excited.
You're right, hon. What happened?
I'm so sorry. Honest to God, right. The past 2 days, something weird with all my electricals has been happening. Like my phone won't work, my charger won't work. My computer won't work. There's like some weird juju going on.
It's fine. I thought it was me at first. I was like, oh, the Wi-Fi's gone or something's happened. But
And Lola's kicking off now.
Oh, is that the dog? I was like, I don't think I've got a dog.
So sorry.
It's fine. Where were we? Yeah, well, while I was waiting, I thought, you know what, I'm just going to cringe out. I found it.
I mean,
But
I thought I was so cool on that other one. But that, you know, that was my first ever, like, proper professional photo shoot. I didn't even know how to smile properly. Yeah, there it is.
The atomic bomb. Maybe that's what it's, atomic bomb. That's probably where they've obviously got it from. No idea.
Yeah.
Right. Moving on. So, one thing I've always wanted to know, this is just a selfish question. There were, by the way, people that wrote questions, I'm really sorry, you're going to have to write them again. I didn't read them. I loved, it's probably a little bit taboo, I loved Precious as well, which obviously Jenny came from Precious to join you, didn't she?
She what, did.
What happened to Precious? Did you split that group up?
Well, we were all out in a nightclub called Pop. That used to be like the place to be
right
when we were kids. And I, like Kerry had already said she was leaving. We'd known for a while. We didn't quite know what we were going to do. But I'd always said Jenny Frost would be perfect.
Yeah.
I said, but obviously she's in Precious. And I don't know. I was like, I don't know what's going on there. I knew things were kind of a bit iffy with them. So we walked into Pop this night and I was just like, Jen was there with the Precious girls and he was celebrating. I was like, what are you celebrating? She went, we've just done our last gig. We've all decided to call it a day. And I went, bathroom, now. Yeah. She was like, what? I was like, toilets, now. Because obviously it was dead loud. It was music. I was like, Jenny, Kerry's left and we need a new member. And she was like, what? I was like, we need a new member. And she went, when? And I was like,
tomorrow.
Now. Like yeah. Tomorrow.
Yeah.
She was like, what do you mean? I was like, we're literally filming the Pepsi chart show tomorrow and we need a third member.
Oh my God, it was that quick. That is
that quick. The next day, Jenny turned up, like to the Pepsi chart show with lyrics on a piece of paper trying to learn the song. That, it was that quick.
That's mad. So, wow.
Because it was like a pre-record, you see. It's going to be a pre-record for like the Sunday or the following week.
Yeah.
And I don't know. It was just kind of like we knew we wanted someone else.
Yeah.
And Jenny was, everyone was just like, yeah, Jenny. Yeah, Jenny. Yeah, Jenny. I was like, I'm going to see her tonight. I'm going to ask her. And she said, yeah. We were like, right, let's go.
Yeah. So like working through the Precious girls. Right, Jenny said no. Right, who's the next one? It's like a... going through. Well, obviously, talk about obviously the Atomic Kitten, Hole Again, mental. You did the thing that I would love to have done, which is done Top of the Pops. Is it as good as it seemed, Top of the Pops? Or was it a bit of a, oh, we need to do it again? Like, was it awesome?
You never got bored of Top of the Pops.
Really?
Because for me, you know, I was watching Top of the Pops from like being a kid. Like, that was my whole childhood.
Yeah,
so the first time we ever did Top of the Pops was with Right Now. And I managed to wangle my mum into the audience. So my mum was like watching us in the audience, like,
that's what you know who you're going to be with sometimes either. Because obviously, depending on the chart, she could be. I spoke to Lolly a few weeks ago and she said she was in. There was like Tom Jones and there was someone else. Because I don't suppose you probably mix with people you'd never normally mix with. You'd be like, oh.
Craig David, so that when the crowd say boat selector, that was number one that week.
Can I get a rewind?
Yeah, so he was on it. I can't remember who else was on it. I mean, to be fair, it was a long time.
It was all about Right Now, the first time.
Yeah.
Then obviously you've got, I mean, there's so much stuff you've done, but I know as well, you went, and then you got the lead in Blood Brothers, which is like huge, like, and the other thing that not a lot of people know this is I saw your, it was a few months ago, your concert, well, someone's put it on YouTube, it was your actual bit that you did before Lionel Richie, because you supported him, and it was your whole, like, solo, like a lot of your solos. I know you did Hole Again and stuff, but I mean, do you miss doing like that kind of music, like the soul, jazz, funk kind of.
I have done, but at the end of summer, so it was like August time last year, my phone rang.
Yeah.
It was a guy who I'd met before, friend of a friend. He was like, I've been trying to get hold of you for about 16 months. I was like, he'd been trying to go through like old management or another company. I was like, oh yeah, no, I'm not with them. He was like, yeah, I know. I've been trying to find you. He's like, how would you feel doing some solo music? And I just started laughing. And he was like, no, I'm being serious.
Yes.
To be honest, I didn't know how I felt at the time. I was like, I don't know. And he was like, look, it'll be on your terms.
Yeah.
You know, we'll work around you and the family, because I know that's really important to you. So I was like, well, yeah, let's give it a go. So I put a band together. We did some gigs towards the end of last year. Now I've been writing some solo material. I've had other writers writing for me as well. My band have remotely been recording the backing tracks and then sending them to me.
Wow. Putting wheels are in motion. That's amazing.
Yeah. I'm going to be recording my first solo album in June.
Oh, what? I mean, that's...
About time.
Yeah. Are you nervous? I bet you're nervous. Are you, I suppose you've got to get the old performing... Do you reckon you're... I mean, it's obviously a long way down the line. Would you like to then... maybe gig with it?
Yeah, I'll definitely gig with it. I mean, freaking hell, that's where the money is, mate.
The honesty, I love it.
No, but I mean, obviously I'm doing it because it's a project I have never been able to get up and running before. Yes, part of it's passion, but I feel like it's just something that it's never quite happened for me, and now I've got the opportunity without any stress. I'm like, this is going to be wonderful. To be honest, I'm glad we're going to tour it because I am very much a live singer.
Yeah,
I hate the recording studio, if I'm being honest. Like, some people love that process. I find it boring. Take after take, I'm like, bleh. Like, it just does my head in. But I feel like I can express myself more live, so
and
I am
looking around. You can, I know you can obviously sing a song, but a track is a track. But with, I think, when you do live gigs, when I've performed, I like sometimes the amount of times I've had to sing Uptown Funk, I've lost count. And it's nice that one of my dancers are in this chat. I'll sing it differently, or I'll change not change the words around, but change the riffs a little bit. And you've got that interaction again, which you just get from, you know, singing it again and again and again and again. And
yeah, it becomes too clean, and I like a bit of dirt in a vocal.
Well, you've obviously, and I also love, I will say, that not many people on here will know this, you're the Round and Round, the Misha Daniels, the dance thing that you did, there's a sample of you on it, which...
The sample is from Gypsy Woman. She wakes up early in the morning just to do her hair now.
Yes.
Cause she can, yo. So yeah. the sample's from that song. I can't remember her name now. Fuck. My mind's gone blank. I put a vocal on it.
Yeah.
It went number one in Brazil for 6 weeks. So random.
As you do. They're in Brazil.
Weird. It never got released in the UK, but I went to Marbella that summer and I was just casually lounging around this pool. There was a pool party on, and the next minute I just heard it and I was like, oh my God. And even my friends hadn't really heard it, and I was going to them, this is my song. They were like, well, I was like, This is my song.
This is me. Yeah.
I mean, like, I'd never had a song in the charts before, but it had been that long. And it was like, as soon as it started, I was going, this is my song.
Crystal Waters.
There we go.
Thank you. I absolutely love it. You're, and obviously, I know you're massive on like the ketones and things like that. I know you obviously speak about this a lot, but I had a couple of questions from people saying exactly what it is. And I know because I've watched your thing. Did you do this ketone thing purely through lockdown to try and do, like me doing this, to keep your brain learning and doing something else?
So to be honest, I just saw a friend of mine talking about them. Callum Best was talking about them on social media. Yeah. They said that they're good for energy and mood. I was like, give me a bit of that, because I was a little bit stressed. I was not in a good place. And I thought, so I'll give it a go.
Yeah.
I genuinely did not think it would have such a positive and profound impact on my life, because what happened after drinking ketones was that I started to find myself again. I got, I had less brain fog. I had really good focus. I had loads of energy. So whereas I felt like before ketones, I was just dragging my ass through the day, just couldn't wait to get to the end of the day and go back to bed.
Yeah.
All of a sudden I had this new lease of life, and I was like, this is like, what is actually in this stuff? It's a little bit weird, but I'm going with it because it makes me feel good. And then I realized there was a business opportunity attached to it. And I thought, well, I am going to be telling everyone about them anyway, so why not just tell people and get paid? So I've actually...
Makes sense.
Yeah. And then obviously lockdown came. I lost all my gigs. Yeah. So I was really thankful that I'd already got, like, I've got a laptop, I've got a phone. I like to talk. You know, I had my ketones in the kitchen. I was like, right, well, let's just see how this goes.
Yeah.
And people listened and people drank them and people wanted to set up their own business because people had their independence taken away from them during lockdown. And this was, you know, this is people's opportunity to gain back some control.
Yeah.
So they could, like, actually have, you know, there's a lot of women out there. They don't have something for themselves. They've dedicated all their life to their kids. You know, some women's partners run the funds of the, you know, the house. So it gives women this independence and opportunity to, like, have something for themselves.
Yeah, definitely.
And I love that because it was the same for me. I have got so much more independence. Like, I can go to the shop and buy what I want. I can plan really nice holidays on my own without a man. And I've been able to do all this through sharing a passion of ketones. So it's been quite the revelation. I mean, I'm a singer and a professional network marketer, which sounds mental.
Mental.
I'm going with it.
You were things you're, I think, like, you know, yourself, a lot of people, you can look at the negative things of any situation. Like this lockdown, I think everyone went for a period of, I don't know about you, but the first part of lockdown, I was like, oh, a break. I can chill. And then the second one, you had Christmas to kind of look forward to, but then it wasn't the same. And I think that's the positive coming out of lockdown, you know, when going through the lockdown of finding who, not just you are as a person, but other things and other avenues you can go down, and actually things you probably wouldn't have thought about if this hadn't have happened. Like,
I've always had a passion for making people feel good. So I did it through my singing for years. There was no better buzz than me being stood on stage and looking out into an audience and seeing people just going, getting into it and feeling good. So for me, I know I need a job with purpose. I need a job that gives back. I need a job that makes people feel good and makes them lead a better bit, be a better version of themselves. So this fits in really well with me. I can work this business from anywhere in the world. You know, it can come with me when I'm going into the recording studio or if I've got gigs here, there and everywhere. So actually, it just fits in perfectly with my life. Yeah. I'm a busy woman, so I need something that can move with me. I don't like staying in one place too long. Lockdown's driven me insane. I've never been at home so much in my life.
Yeah, I'm just over it. Just absolutely over. I think I'm just over as well. I like to see that I'm fine with the journey as long as I've got a goal and I can see where I'm going to be. Like, I just need to know there's a light at the end of the tunnel.
Absolutely. I've been self-employed since I was 16. You know, so it's always kind of been on my shoulders to go out there, find the work and pay the freaking bills. You know, it's always been like this big thing on my shoulders. Oh my God, where am I going to get, like, how's this year going to plan out?
How's this year's textbooks going to look? That's what I keep thinking. Like,
I've had a good year, I'm not going to lie.
I'm glad you have. Literally, like, right? OnlyFans it is.
It's a rarity, but I mean, I've worked really hard, so.
Yeah.
You know, you can always put it in.
Well, promoting and mentoring. You do your the Zooms as well, chatting to people from all over the world, which, you know, in itself is amazing.
I know, by the way, if I look distracted, I've got my WhatsApp's going off. I don't need to be on a call in 7 minutes. I'm like, okay.
I'll get to some questions that some people have asked. Is that all right?
Yeah.
I don't want to
go on.
Right. There were some questions. So there was a question on here. What do you think of today's music, lack of girl bands, boy bands?
What do I think of it? I mean, this is the thing, right? It's rubbish. Like, it is rubbish.
Yeah.
But I really don't understand how the music industry works anymore. But what I have realised is there's a lot of inequality when it comes to gig lineups. It's always the men pushed over the women, and it pisses me off.
Yeah.
And I'm getting to a point in my life, I'm like, how can you, as a promoter, how do you think this is okay to give 7 male artists? Oh, and everyone, like, look at this lineup. And I'm not saying give it to Atomic Kitten. I'm saying we are just as talented as any man out there. So share the roster, peeps. Because it's pissing me off.
Because it's getting on my nerves. What would you be your favourite? This is from Rory Finn _3. What would you be your favourite musical to be in if you had a role that was your favourite role?
I mean, to be honest, I did have I played Mrs. Johnson in Blood Brothers. It doesn't get any better than that. But if I could play another one, I would definitely have to go into Chicago.
Yeah, Roxy. Which would be the Roxy or Velma. Yeah.
Yeah, Roxy, of course, Roxy.
Right. What I do like at the very end is, how long have you got? You got 5 minutes?
I've got four minutes.
Right, we'll do this quick. So, you've basically, it's how well you know your own songs or your own thing. So, what is after this? You ready? Yes. Occasional Rain, Chili Con Carne, Sparkling Champagne. And you have sang this. Get the brain
let
working.
Let there be cuckoos, a lark and a dove. But most yes! of all, please, let there be love.
Yeah, okay. You said you're going to call me and I went by the phone.
Oh, God, this is an Atomic Kitten song, isn't it?
Yeah. I love the fact you got the swing one straight away.
Do you know what it is? It's not my line, so I don't know.
I think you sing an hour white by the phone. It's See Ya.
God.
Okay. Trust your feelings. They will guide you.
Happiness will soon come home to you.
Yes. And last one. You don't have to...
be rich.
Less of a song, more of a...
You don't have to shout. You don't have to shout.
Babe, you should have copyrighted that and had that on T-shirts, mugs, birthday cards. You'd have made a mint. Literally.
To be honest, when I was that traumatised when I came home about a Big Brother, I was just like, I need to go on the down low for a while.
Right. Quick fire. Gladys Knight, Dusty Springfield. Which one?
Gladys.
Britain's Got Talent, X Factor.
X Factor.
Wembley or the O2 Arena?
O2.
Smash Hits Magazine, Top of the Pops Magazine.
Smash it.
A beer or a cocktail?
A beer.
Last three. A tattoo or a piercing?
Oh, God. A piercing, because tattoos are a nightmare to get rid of.
Yep. Hole again, right now.
At hole again.
Go back in Big Brother or have another lockdown?
Big Brother, it's over sooner.
And the last, your greatest piece of advice for anyone?
Don't give a shit what anyone else thinks. If you want to go and do it, if you've got the passion, the drive, the grit, the determination, just follow your heart, follow your dreams, go out there and do it.
Smash it. That's brilliant. Thank you, babe, so much for doing this. With all the connection stuff, we got there in the end. I really do appreciate it.
We did. Here's Ella.
Hello, Miss Ella, you're going to be a performer one day.
Do you think you're going to be on stage?
I think I might be singing and acting.
Yeah. I saw my headdress. Like, or she could be a hairdresser. Or she could be a hairdresser. I saw you do your mum's hair. Good job.
Yesterday, me two braids and me like little beaver bit at the back. Yeah, it was interesting, wasn't it?
Well, look, I'll go and let you enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you so much for doing this, Tash. I really appreciate
it. Thank you. Thanks so much. I'm sorry for the blip.
That's fine. No worries. Lots of love and stay safe.
Take care.
Bye. Bye.